China is a very irresponsible upper riparian state. China never needs anything to justify anything. China can do whatever it feels like, and it has got a range of experts, cartographic manipulators, I'll call them. It has a discipline which is called lawfare. They have this very convenient method of keeping it on a cold storage and then quickly bringing it out, depending on what are their, you know, requirements. You know, many of us, when we look at first island chain, second island chain, we only look at islands in South China Sea or East China Sea. It is not really that. It's a parabola. And that parabola incidentally covers these all states which we are talking about. They are Chinese. They can do it. And China has got this beautiful method of painting it in a victim syndrome. This is the Chinese power of information warfare, or this is the lawfare. That name has become like this, that you begin to wonder that it's Chinese given name. So it should be Chinese claim. They never sort of thought of Galwan kind of resoluteness at tactical level. They never thought of that we defensive Indians will transit to offensive QPK and do Kailash on them. So Kunming has got two or three satellite towns. One famous town is Ruili. Ruili is the black market for small arms, and all these people are buying their weapons from there. Because BSF looks after Bangladesh border, SSB looks after Nepal border and Bhutan border, and ITB looks after China. See the complication mix here. And there is no unified headquarters person. You know, there are coordination headquarters.
Jai Hind, welcome to Dev Talks. This is a very special subject. It's about the Chinese interest in the Northeast. We are all aware of the Chinese eyeing our land in the eastern part of our country in various different places. They have sometimes made absurd claims and also have used their military to push forth their objectives. There is also a thought process that says today that their failure in Ladakh may also mean that they would try the next time in the east. To discuss that, I have with me Lieutenant General KJ Singh, PDSM, AVSM, bar to AVSM. He was superannuated from the army in 2016 August after 39 years of distinguished service. He commanded a formidable Western Command, an operationally committed corps in the Northeast, having borders with four countries, an armored division in the strike corps, a T-90 armored brigade, and the elite armored regiment of 63rd Cavalry, which incidentally is the same one that he was commissioned into. What an honor, sir. He is currently holding the prestigious Ranjit Singh Chair of Excellence in the Punjab University of Chandigarh. Today, he's a strategic thinker, a writer, and a speaker on various different issues concerning our great nation. Thank you so much for joining me today, sir, on this very interesting debate or discussion with regards to Chinese interest in the Northeast.
Thank you, Adi. Thank you for a very generous introduction that you have given me. I have been enthused. I've been watching your channel, which is in a way making waves, and a lot of very pertinent and very contemporary subjects are getting discussed. And allow me to compliment you. You're making a very good mark in this field. As regards my introduction, I'll just focus it on this thing that I had a unique opportunity, though I come from mechanized corps, armored corps, to serve in Nagaland, Northeast. And that time my formation used to look after entire range of states in Northeast. That would mean that Nagaland, Manipur, parts of Mizoram, South Assam, and Arunachal. So we looked after all that area. So that was as a colonel. As a corps commander, I was looking after, I was commanding the Sikkim Corps, which has borders with four countries, and where this Doklam incident took place after 4 years after I left. And as a Western Army commander, in my remit was Himachal border, which has got about 200 kilometers of borders with China. So China has always been my interest, and in the army headquarters also, this raising of the mountain pole, I had some role to play. In the sense, the entire paper was worked out by a team and I had to be part of that. So thank you for this generous introduction, and I have tried to qualify it to bring it closer to the subject that we are discussing. Thank you, Adi.
Thank you, sir, for your generous words, and I'm glad that you recognize the effort. Sir, I'd like to begin with a very basic question, sir. You know, what is China's interest in the Northeast? How does he justify it on a historical as well as a legal, context?
Firstly, Adi, China never needs anything to justify anything. China can do whatever it feels like, and it has got a range of experts, cartographic manipulators, I'll call them. It has a discipline which is called lawfare, where legal treaties are interpreted the way they feel like it. So, we'll come to that part a little later. But let us first look at Chinese interests. What are these interests in Northeast? China really considers Northeast and Southeast Asia, we are part of Southeast Asia in that context, as its natural backyard. That is the Chinese feeling. And if you were to stretch your right hand and look at the palm, and China considers that palm is Tibet, and it has got five fingers. And the five fingers that which are there are Ladakh, Nepal, Sikkim, Bhutan, and Arunachal. And it feels that it is their natural interest, natural desire, and it should happen that way. It is inevitable in their thinking that this palm is not complete without five fingers. So it's got desire like that. China has got also a very sort of, and it goes to the extent of calling these, like it calls Arunachal as South Tibet. That is, it says it's South Tibet, it's natural extension of Tibet. Their insecurities can also be understood in the context of Malacca dilemma. The Chinese energy flow passes through Malacca Straits, and it is a choke point. Now, China is doing everything that is possible to find alternative access and outlets outside. So, that's how you can understand Gwadar, their bases in Djibouti, their footprints in Africa, and they're trying to get a base in Hambantota, Colombo Port, Kra Canal, Kiepu in Myanmar, and even developing a port in Bangladesh. It's all part of it. That insecurity, which is Malacca dilemma, it doesn't want to live with that. In the same context, Chinese also have got, if you look at China, it has got a core. But core has got autonomous regions based on ethnic profile of those regions. So you have Inner Mongolia, you have Ningxia Hui, where Hui Muslims live. These are in the north, and that they are not so relevant to discussion today. But in the context, we can see their insecurities. But more importantly, they have Xinjiang, where they are having problems with Uyghurs. And then they have Tibet. And then they have this Guangxi, where they had the issues with Vietnam and all this. So these outlying autonomous regions is something that China wants to integrate completely. It is doing demographic inversion. It's doing henization. It is, it wants to keep them under very strict watch, control. It is scared that, and in Tibet, there have been problems. There was immolations. There were, and Dalai Lama is one irritant in their mind. And resources wise also, this is a huge, big market, Southeast Asia and these areas. There is fresh water. Brahmaputra, and China is having problem in Mekong River. China is a very irresponsible upper riparian state. And I told you about access, market, water. Also, ideologically, China would like this region to be either governed by communism, communist states, or by military rulers. They'll prefer that. But democracy is something which they are not very comfortable. So hence their indulgence or their dilemmas or their interferences in Nepal and trying to promote Oli, who's from the Nepal Communist Party, Maoist Communist Center, and Prachanda. Both are communist parties. So their concentrated kind of efforts, their ambassador trying to behave like a regent and making comments along. So why only Nepal? Even in Myanmar, they've not been comfortable with Aung San Suu Kyi. China feels that the generals are better. So Chinese, even in Indian context, China has been promoting left-wing extremism. It would want communism to somehow survive and prosper here. Because after all, China is selling an alternate model. And which seems to be becoming somewhat attractive also. If you can lift so many people out of poverty, then is democracy alone the answer? These questions are being asked in many countries. And on two other issues, I would quickly cover about their interests. They have a kind of feeling that all people who are Mongoloid race, they have some kind of racial affinity. So people in Northeast, Southeast have that kind of. They are different from, say, from Aryans and who have got different kind of, or Dravidians who are in South. So people in Northeast are a different race, which is a Thai, Tibetan kind of a race. And they also have, despite their being communists, they feel that they have some kind of a sort of, they should have a controlling stake on the Buddhism. So Buddhist countries also, they like to have their influence and they like to have their footprints. Now you ask this very relevant questions about how is it to be justified? After all, this point has to be sold to people. It has to be, people have to be convinced about this. Firstly, historically, from 1908, where they articulated this, Imperial Resident Commissioner of Tibet had said that you must go back to Qing Dynasty and the footprint of Qing Dynasty, which incidentally includes all this. And this was repeated by Mao Zedong in 1939, he repeated it. Articulations are such that they occasionally bring up what was told in 1962 or 64, and there's a 1959 claim. They suddenly bring it up. They have this very convenient method of keeping it on a cold storage and then quickly bringing it out, depending on what are their, you know, requirements. If you look at the thing about the first island chain, you know, many of us, when we look at first island chain, second island chain, we only look at islands in South China Sea or East China Sea. It is not really that. It's a parabola. And that parabola incidentally covers these all states which we are talking about. Maybe. It covers those five fingers. It covers even down to Southeast Asia. So, and see, like I told you, how can you justify 9 dashes then? But Chinese are pushing it. They're Chinese. They can do it. And China has got this beautiful method of painting it in a victim syndrome, saying that we were ruled by very sort of unreasonable kind of colonial powers. You know, Britishers, Japanese and Koreans, they have all ruled over China. And they say that these people have actually subjugated us, taken away our natural territories, have done the cartographic manipulation. They put it on the other person. And they are not sort of, and they, based on this, they have this, actually, we and our universities must invest in this. After all, when we'll come to this point later, when this Doklam happened, we don't have enough documents to support our claim. Whereas, you know, all universities will do seminars, something on China, something on this thing. But nobody is studying the relevance of Mount Gitmochi and the maps about it. So there's a need for a focused kind of study on these kind of subjects. So I leave it here that China considered this as a natural extension of its palm, its hand. It also thinks it's their backyard, so they have a right to be here. And historically, it invents justifications. They may not seem valid to us, but then China is China.
Thank you, sir, for that answer. I think you hit the nail right on the spot. As a matter of fact, Chinese have this wonderful ability to package stuff and put it across to people and again and again and again and again and again, and to a point where actually somebody starts doubting what he's trying to say himself. And the three warfare strategy, they, with regards to public opinion and the propaganda part of it, they take it very seriously, and they've been putting it. I agree with you what you're trying to say. And they've been able to actually sell a lot of stuff to a lot of people with, for example, the 1959 line that you mentioned. I don't think India has ever ratified any such line of any kind. But just because they are putting it across and they are packaging it and selling it across, there are discussions within us. And that is exactly what they want. They want a relevance to be created over that 1959 line by discussing it within India somehow or the other. And it's an amazing ability that one must learn. And I agree with you that there has to be a concerted effort to understand this and counter it. So one saw, you know, last year during the Ladakh standoff, one saw some activity at the Nakula Pass. It's been a while. There have been probing incidents that happen, and you've been, you know, commander of that entire region. You've served in the entire Northeast. So I'm sure, you know, you'll be more aware of the kind of probing that the Chinese do. But in hindsight, sir, how do you look at that action that happened in Nakula? Was it just a probing incident, looking at what was happening in Ladakh, or was it a plan to do something larger?
See, Adi, if we look at Sikkim, incidentally, is not covered under LAC. It is considered to be IB by us, international border, because Sikkim had a settlement with Tibet, and that is well documented. So we take it that that border of about 200 odd kilometers is, we take it. But that is our perception. What China does is that starting from, if you look at Sikkim and just visualize Sikkim's map in your mind, and when you show it to your viewers, you may consider showing it. So I'll try and take them along that map. That if you start from, say, from the west or from the left-hand side, from the Nepal side, you see Mount Karakoram, and then you come to a valley, which is a glaciated valley, which is called Mugu-Thang. Now, Mugu-Thang was wasteland. Nobody went over there. We also did not hold it with any significant forces. Earlier, Assam Rifle used to have an odd company there. Then we gave it to ITBP. And in Mugu-Thang, Nakula is the watershed, that is the pass. Okay, so thereafter you have Kerang Plateau, where we've been having problems on various canes. Then you turn and you come to Nathula and Doklam and all those areas. But let's look at this Mugu-Thang, where Nakula is. I would say during my tenure, that would be about 2014, I left in 2013. Even till I retired, 2016, nothing happened in Nakula. Nothing really. Chinese used to come, patrol, leave some cans, some, you know, soft water, soft drink cans and cigarettes just to show their presence of Chinese marking. And we also patrol like this, and it used to be sort of reported as the Chinese king. That's all. Now in 2017, Chinese suddenly made a pitch for Nakula. And what Nakula is really, if you come to Nakula, you go nowhere, because then there is a glaciated kind of valley. You have to traverse for good 60-70 kilometers till you hit some kind of habitation. There are no real habitations. Only people go for pasture activities with their yaks. That's all. So it's not a hell of a, there's no agriculture, there is no real pasture also. Throughout the year, it's only for some season. So in 2017, they activated, and now again they activated. In between also, they did it once. Why did they do it? Basically, in my perception, it is a kind of a diversion. You divert the attention here. and then you do the DAP. So while you are focused here and you start something in Ladakh. Also, in this area, there are Chinese are wanting to activate this area. See, this is, we'll come to it later when we discuss Doklam also. Like I would link it up with your previous point and bring one connect here, that till I retired in 2016, mid-2016, I never knew this word Doklam. I knew that place like back of my hand. I was one of the few corps commanders who physically went there walking and spent a night there at Doklam or Dolam. We called it Dolam. We called it Dupala. Now the parlance has changed. Entire world, including Indians, call it Doklam. I don't know why. If we were calling it Dolam Plateau, why aren't we calling it Dolam Plateau? Why have we changed? This is the Chinese power of information warfare. Or this is the lawfare. That name has become like this, that you begin to wonder that it's Chinese given name. So it should be Chinese claim. So China is wanting to activate, and China, see, China's philosophy of border management in earlier times used to be that they used to have their bases in the hinterland, in bases like Yatung. Like if you see Nakula, there is a station or a military station called as Lavu Gompa, and there is Farijong. So they would have their bases there, and from there they would launch patrols at a frequency of their choice, timing and place is their choice. It's a wonderful strategy because you keep the other man always in a sense of surprise. He's always up on his guards. He can come anywhere. And there is no patrolling program as such. You don't know when he's coming. So you have to keep your guard up. That was the Chinese philosophy. Now what has happened to Adis? They are changing. They are now transiting, surprisingly, to a strategy of basing troops in forward areas, which is happening across Ladakh and all. It's not a sensible strategy. In years to come, Chinese will do this because it is heavy in cost, manpower, mountain siege troops. You have to have those many people. It is, logistically, it is a nightmare. You have to sustain them. It is also a problem health-wise. So why should you do this kind of thing? If you were Chinese used to be in heated shelters in Lavu Gompa, oxygenated tents. Now suppose they bring and put people like we have got in Kerala. Our people are hardy. They'll have to harden their people. Even if you harden the people, we have to rotate them. After every 1 year, we bring our troops down, send fresh people. So you need more people to rotate. So Chinese border management strategy itself, in my perception, is undergoing a change. Why is it doing it? Probably our infrastructure is reaching those areas. Earlier it wasn't there. So these are the challenges which are developing. And I'll leave it here. And maybe we'll come back to it later if we have time.
Absolutely, sir. Sir, I agree with you. As a matter of fact, I'd like to also say that the Chinese motive has been much debated within a lot of strategic circles in India. And of course, there are a lot of views which have come out. And, you know, it'll be interesting. I'll keep this for a little bit of a later discussion. But I'd like to ask you another question concerning the East. A lot of the strategic experts today say that, you know, the Chinese have tasted a bit of a bad medicine in Ladakh because of the factors that you yourself mentioned, that the troops need to be stationed at very high altitude. It becomes a health problem and this and that. Whereas the case may not be the same in the Northeast, or may not be as extreme in the Northeast. And a lot of the experts, as I said, even in the introduction, feel that the next push, whenever it does come, and would be in the northeastern part of the country. What is your opinion in that, sir?
See, Adi, you have very rightly said one thing, that the terrain is distinctly different in Northeast. Like Northeast is not so glaciated, very few stretches are. Northeast also does not have so much of snow cover, and vegetation is higher. So oxygen, like when you go to Leh is not very high, it's about 10,000 feet. But in Leh, you feel distinct drop in oxygen level. But in Northeast, places like Tawang, which are much higher, you don't feel oxygen depletion. You don't really feel it because the vegetation cover in Northeast is much larger. So it's a different kind of higher altitude warfare. Chinese may be more comfortable. And Chinese, on the other side, have plateaus which is flatter. So their access and all, the communication radiates from Lhasa. It comes to Lhasa, and from Lhasa it goes towards Arunachal, and it also goes towards Sikkim and bordering areas of Nepal. And Ladakh is one extreme it is. So to that extent, logistical challenges in this part are less. So will China do it here? Nobody can predict it. I must tell you that. With Chinese, it's not possible to predict. Actually, that way, central sector, which is Barahoti and opposite Uttarakhand, is more vulnerable because we have critical vulnerabilities in that. We are trying to redress it. Initially, we had shortage of troops. Now, we have redressed that. Our infrastructure is not so robust over there. So, to that extent, that would also be a challenge. And you cannot rule out PLA trying something funny in Arunachal. There are areas, there are places like Tangse and others where we have issues with them. And they have been occasionally doing transgressions. So if they would like to solidify, because after all, they feel that this is an extension of South Tibet. And if you see Dalai Lama, he came to India not through Ladakh. He came through these areas.
Yes.
His temporal seats are in he may be currently sitting in Himachal, Dharamshala, but his following, his temporal seats are all across in Chumbi Valley, across Tawang. So those are theologically more important places. So if China wants to send a message, it can definitely do it in this way. And I don't even rule out the most ignored sector of Himachal. There also they've got border of about 200 odd kilometers. We have trade taking place from Shipkila Pass.
Yes.
So will they make it to over there? We really don't. So we have to keep our guard up on. Like when I was building up my formations in Himachal, a lot of people used to ask me that this is a holiday destination. And you are putting so much of effort, you are this thing. But then with Chinese, you should never, never trust. You should build your capabilities and be prepared for the worst. So you are right on the ball. You are right on the target when you say that next challenge may come in Arunachal or in the North. We have to be prepared for it.
So I'm going to just pick this up and with regards to the discussion that we kind of left for a little later and combine both of them and ask you, one, why did the Chinese then choose Ladakh? And two, what was their strategic motive or what was their tactical motive on the ground in Ladakh, sir?
See, Ladakh is to be seen in relation to CPEC, China-Pak Economic Corridor. So strategic spaces over there are incidentally the eastern part and middle part of Aksai Chin, where they need the depth for their highway. They also have interests in Sakshgam Valley, which is the reservoir of fresh water, which probably they needed for manufacturing silicon chips.
Yeah.
So, and they were concerned about our creeping infrastructure. So, to that extent, you know, Daulat Beg Oldi is not a great airfield or hardly used also, not as such. But it has got a lot of significance or messaging there. So, ideally, China would like to straighten that thing and link up to China-Pak Economic Corridor from here. Or it'd like to have buffer. And it was also probably trying to show us our place. So it was easy to do it here. They would have seen that they would have done their testing, their wargaming, they would have analyzed it properly. So that's how they chose this area. And they managed to sort of, they have conveyed a message to us that if you look at the comprehensive national park, there's a huge, big summit track. And we have limitations. We have, unlike Kargil, we cannot throw out Chinese physically. We have to negotiate with them and look for status quo if it ever happens.
I think that's very interesting, sir, because a lot of, you know, even I think that fair enough, they wanted to come and give a message to us for various different reasons. Growing India's power, they were probably a little jealous of what is happening in India, whatever it is. The creeping infrastructure, the closeness to US, there are various factors, you know, that combined into this whole thing. But then for them to choose a place where they themselves were getting so badly hurt with regards to weather and everything like that doesn't really, you know, it doesn't really fit well into the whole game when you actually think that the Chinese are really, really thinking about their stuff. Either that or they thought that they would just come and give us a bit of a push and we'll probably fold back, which, you know, fortunately
see,
for us.
Adi, like what you are saying, the Chinese came with this belief that they'll just fool it and we will not. They never sort of thought of Galwan kind of resoluteness at tactical level. They never thought of that we defensive Indians will transit to offensive QPK and do Kailash on them. So these things they had not bargained for. And that's how they felt that very quickly India will be brought into subjugation. Mm. It will agree to join CPAC. It will, they were not happy about our getting close to USA. And also they have certain milestones of their centenary goals, and they're celebrating in July their centenary of their party. So they had these kind of compulsions. So all combined, and maybe it is, I call it a 65 syndrome. Pakistan attacked us in 65 because certain think tanks told them that it is now or never. If you don't attack India now, you will India will take such a lead, you will never be able to attack them. So do it now. So maybe they realized, or China thought, that if we don't do it now, India would close the gap. And then they will not be able to put it across.
Very, very interesting, sir. I must say, I must compliment you on that line of thought. Sir, I'd like you to, you know, now comment on the Dolam standoff that occurred there in 2017. A lot of UN cry was created by China. Even now, they, if you see their Global Times, which is probably the biggest mouthpiece that the Chinese army has, there are multiple references of 2017 in a very sly fashion, not very, very glaringly up there in the headlines, but it's there somewhere mentioned whenever the India-China standoff sort of a thing is written about. I'd like you to tell us your opinion. One, what really happened there, and the battle of the two peaks, as you actually put it across before, because that's a very interesting thing, how the Chinese are twisting the narrative again to their advantage. And two, where do you see the situation going forward, sir?
Dolam Plateau, which Chinese have now managed to make it Doklam, is actually a trilateral issue. This plateau is incidentally a point of contest between Bhutan and China. India is just to, as a third party, which is sort of giving some kind of support to Bhutan. Because traditionally, you see, what has happened in my perception is, in India, the narrative has been that Himalaya is a huge, big barrier. It will always protect us. That was because you had buffer state of Tibet. But somewhere that buffer state vanished. And Chinese, with their push, with their endeavor, brought the infrastructure very close to the box. So that factor about China being a remote country, Himalaya being a barrier has vanished. China is on our borders. So similarly, in this area also, and also somewhere we were, Sikkim was some kind of a protectorate for us. So we have inherited that kind of legacy or that kind of responsibility. And Bhutan to that extent also. Sikkim and Bhutan were similar kind of configuration. So here, Dolab or Doklam Plateau, China has a claim which links it to watershed principle. Whereas in Ladakh, it doesn't accept the watershed principle. But in this part of the world, they don't mind McMahon line being accepted. They don't mind that watershed principle in parts. Now, this watershed is between the rivers of Tista. That is the watershed. And it is linked to Mount Gip Mochi, which certain texts also call as Gimochi. Now, where is Gip Mochi? That is where there is a debate and discussion. China tends to believe that Gip Mochi is where India has currently a place called as Gimochin. And Gimochin, that is much south where China wants to get it. And Gip Mochi, which we are saying, is an extension of Merugla Sinchela Ridge. That's the watershed. That's the real watershed. So on the principle of watershed, we are probably right. And we are going to extend it that way. But Chinese don't accept it. Now, Chinese came here and came here with a very strange kind of a proposition Chinese came. This was one time where Chinese went to media. Earlier, Chinese have never gone to media whenever they have come for a transgression. They have left it to weaker nation to cry. But here, they went to media, they put out maps, they put out information, and it was actually a very sad thing for them. By doing that, they also get bad name. They got an egg in their face because India stood up. So if it was under the wraps, it could have been handled in a very different way. But since they had gone to the media, to the world, crying and announcing that we are doing this and all, now it was very difficult for them to roll back. Here, China has claims in Bhutan, which are strange claims. You know, like in Bhutan, if you look at this, this is one claim. And here they've set up a village also.
Yeah.
They've gone to, but it to an extent, it is illogical because all over we are dominating. We are sitting at a height, they are into a plateau, kind of a bowl. So in Bhutan, there are two or three stretches which are disputed. One is an area which is called as Jakarlang and Fodrang. Now this is in the northern Bhutan and which is about 495-500 square kilometers. This vis-a-vis this disputed area of Dolam or Doklam, which is around 269 square kilometers. So Chinese say, we leave the claim in the north and you give us this. Because they want to enlarge Chumbi Valley. Chumbi Valley narrows down where it points like a dagger into our this thing. Because Chumbi Valley goes to Jamfari Ridge. And from Jamfari Ridge, or which people call as Jamfari Ridge also, in the evening when they are bound to have a drink, jam, so they call it Jamfari. But it's actually Jamfari Ridge. So Jamfari Ridge actually gives you certain kind of domination or a rollback kind of or a roll down capability towards Jal Dhaka and Siliguri Port. It's not that easy, but notionally it gives you that capability. So India has some quick reaction troops always to go and occupy that. And here, Bhutan is, India has been trying to tell Bhutan that let's have joint border manning, but Bhutan also wants to maintain its autonomy. It doesn't allow it. There is a Chela border post which it mans, where Chinese used to come earlier also. And now, if you look at it in Bhutan, China has laid claim to another place, which is Sakteng Sanctuary, which is a reserve forest kind of area, that borders Arunachal. They have laid a claim there also. So China, and this was, in my perception, Doklam was handled very well by India. Very well, very resolute. They stood the ground, and they even used naval assets to do surveillance, which was not done earlier. And we did not go to media at all. We kept our cool, and we told Chinese, you cannot go in from here. And China was forced to settle down. Now, there are different schools of thought. Some people say China has expanded their made facilities. But that is, in my perception, ego kind of an issue. Can China outflank from that side? Well, China can do it. We have to remain vigilant. We have to. But it's not easy. It's not easy to get to Siliguri Corridor. We have sufficient troops. We have population.
That's a, you know.
Doklam was well-handled.
Yeah, actually, sir, one of the biggest problems in India is everybody, and I say this with all the humility, one of the reasons I actually started this channel was to negate the nonsense, I'm sorry to use that word, which is being used across by putting lines on a satellite map. I find that to be absurd because a lot of people don't even realize that there is something known as scale. When they draw a line on a satellite map that probably covers 30, 50 kilometers of land. So I'd like to take the Chinese influence in the Northeast as my next question. You know, we had a couple of incidents before where they issued staple visas. They've been trying to connect with the people there. They protest every time a senior member of the government goes to Arunachal Pradesh, as a matter of fact. But one also sees that, you know, the influence of China within that region has come down to a large extent. Do you think that the Chinese today actually realize that sentiment which is building in India, or really, they really don't care because something that is again evident by the way they treat their minorities or their people that they're not very enthusiastic about in Xinjiang and so on and so forth? What is your opinion, sir?
See, Adi, like there is this famous saying that you can choose your friends, but you can't choose your neighbors. Now, China happens to be a neighbor. Now, we have to roll back this story to 50s, when the Naga insurgency started. Where did these people escape? Mobu Angami and generals of Naga army, they went running to China. And they came to Bangladesh, which was East Pakistan. So, Pakistan's story starts from there, supporting insurgency in Northeast. So these people drew support from China. And you are right to that extent. I remember there's a book written by a Swedish journalist who's a regional expert. His name is Bertil Lindner. He wrote this book in 2012, which is called The Great Game East, India, China, and the Struggle for Asia's Most Volatile Frontier. So what does he surmise? He says, the Chinese indulgence in the insurgent groups or militants of Northeast is not same anymore. But that doesn't mean that China is not giving them access to the gray market and even black market. See, if you look at Myanmar, India, China, that tri-junction area, and you go up, there is this Yunnan province. And in that, there is a town called as Kunming. This entire thing of China wanting a pipeline to Kunming, it's already laid it. It's connectivity over there. So Kunming has got two or three satellite towns. One famous town is Ruili. Ruili is the black market for small arms. And all these people are buying their weapons from there.
From there.
2 years back, there was a story that Arakan Army, an insurgent group operating in Myanmar. And Wa Army, which is operating in the northern Myanmar, the Chins, they were facilitating arms supply through ISI to Indian insurgent groups. So today also, the top leadership of NSC and IM, which has gone underground, the part which has gone underground, like Funthing Shimrang, his group, they are sitting in China, sitting in Kunming, Ruili, and all these areas. The top leadership of NSCNK always operated from China. The leaders of Ulfa Independent, the faction which is, Paresh Barua and these people, they are also in China. So, while China may not be giving active support, but China has also not, and in Chinese parlance, nothing can happen without government's clearance. So, it is ready to allow them. To that extent, the nuisance factor carries on. We have to sort out this problem ourselves and make it difficult for these leaders to come and find base over there. It's strange. It's a very silly kind of thing. The provinces over there like Mizoram and Nagaland are very Christian oriented. Yet they allow themselves to be manipulated by communists. So, but it is there. That reality is there. So, I would put it this way, that Chinese influence has gone down, but nuisance value has not finished. And all insurgent groups over here who indulge in shady activities, they have to park their money of extortion, of there are all kinds of activities that take place, gun running, arms trafficking, extortion, kidnapping, timber smuggling, wildlife product smuggling, narcotics, that money which is garnered through that, you have to somehow exchange it to buy goodies. Well, China is not the place to educate your children. They don't send their children there. But China is certainly facilitating that kind of process for these kids.
It's a messy affair, sir, won't you agree?
No, it's a very messy affair. And the thing is, there is a deniability clause built in. China is not only doing to us, it is doing to Myanmar.
Correct.
It is also doing in parts to Bangladesh because of Rohingya factor. It is also doing to Thailand.
Thailand.
But the problem is China is so powerful that see, this Mekong Delta, the people who are at the tail end of Delta have no water. They are crying. But what do they do besides crying? Because China doesn't listen. Like, we paid money to China for hydrological data to set up facilities. We paid money. Still, they didn't provide them when Doklam. So, or you see what has happened in Ladakh. We have whole range of protocols, confidence building measures that you will not bring any troops within 20 kilometers and all that kind of thing. But has it stopped them from doing what they wanted to? So if there is a country which doesn't respect, or if you see, there is a verdict of International Court of Justice arbitration about islands, Philippine district, Scarborough Shoal, and Mischief Reef and all, and Shansha kind of a base which China has developed. But has it dissuaded China from doing what they're doing?
No.
They don't recognize. So it's messy. It is difficult.
Not
but
only,
Chinese footprint is there.
Not only don't they recognize it, sir, they come with 200 mercenary ships and stand in the Philippine Sea. So it just tells you that their thought process is completely warped. I think one thing one must understand, if you're studying the Chinese this way, you must also look the other way around and figure out what's happening with them, because they are unpredictable in that sense. So, we were talking about the Siliguri corridor, and this has been in discussion for a long time with regard internal security of the country. I don't want to get into the political aspect of it, but it has been in discussion with regards the internal security. It's been in discussion with regards the Chinese threat. Now, in recent news, we saw that the Bangladeshis are trying to do a huge deal with the Chinese with regards the Teesta River Valley project, which, of course, adjoins the Siliguri corridor. How do you think this whole, it obviously creates a bit of a raw nerve within India that, this is not correct. How do you look at this, sir?
See, Siliguri corridor is a very critical vulnerability for us. People call it chicken snack It's about 200 kilometer, you know, lengthwise. And at places, it narrows down to 18 to 20 kilometers. And at its broadest, it is 67 kilometers. Well within range of, you know, long-range missiles or artillery portion properly. So it is a critical vulnerability. It's got connectivity to 8 states in India. It's northeastern states. It is incidentally also the gateway to 4 countries. Northern Bangladesh, the eastern, southeastern Nepal. It provides connectivity to Bhutan. And somewhere China also wants to connect to the Jamshedpur Bridge. And frankly, all construction material, all sort of manufacturing material in 3-4 countries like Nepal, Bhutan, and even northern Bangladesh originates from Siliguri. Siliguri has got that kind of importance. Unfortunate part is, before I go to that part, ethnically, it's a very dangerous place, Siliguri corridor, because it has got large number of disparate kind of tribes. There are Gurkhas which are looking for autonomy. There are Bhutias and Lepchas which are tribal people who are saying Gurkhas are overriding them. Because when we look at Gurkhas, our mind only pictures Gurkha as a very loyal guard who's standing outside the building. You know, first thought which comes to our mind is Shabji, you know, we stereotype Gurkhas like that. But no, Gurkhas are in this part of the world mercantile people, very mobile. They are actually like Marwadis. I must challenge you with this thought, because Sikkim originally was inhabited by Bhutias and Lepchas. Bhutias were rulers and Lepchas were majority at that time. Today, who rules Sikkim? Nepalese. You look at the chief ministers of Sikkim. You look at Nar Bahadur Bhandari, Pawan Chamling, the current chief minister Gole are all Nepalese. All trade is controlled by them. They have taken over. Even in Bhutan, there used to be a set of people which were called Bhuplis. Nepalese settled in southern Bhutan who were taking over till they were thrown out from there. I'm not saying throw them out. But this tribe, unlike are thinking they may be docile or not doing such trades in India. But in that part, they control the economy. They very quickly take over. So Nepalese ethnic stock is there. Gurkhas are there. Then there are people from Dwars, which are the tea garden areas and which is the area of Jalpaiguri. And then there are insurgencies which are taking place in Kamthap. You know, Rajbanshis, from where Gayatri Devi came. So that is also there. Then there are ethnic settlements there. Even Maithis had come from Manipur. In any case, there are large number of Muslim-dominated towns, like Malda is there in the bordering areas. And there is this place called as Kamiachak, where every house got bomb-making unit, counterfeit currency unit. Kaniachak is known for that. So you have to Google and you'll read about that. So if you look at these books, like Humphrey Huxley has written a book called as Dragonfire, and Colonel SS Putalia has written another book called as Assassin's Base. Now these two books picture a scenario that China very quickly comes and takes over Siliguri. These are fictional accounts, but they are like what Arthur Haley used to write down, that kind of thing, those kind of things. So they are related to geographical realities and all this. But I have been a corps commander there. And I can share this with you, that when I was corps commander, the people in my command headquarters were not happy with me, because I was a little independent kind of person. So in my war game, they tried to fix me by coming through the Siliguri corridor. And they did things which are not logical, which are not operationally possible. But it was allowed to them because they were themselves controlling that war. But yet at every stage, we had an answer for that. So we have war gamed it. We have enough troops. It's not easy to come and take over Siliguri corridor. unless you do it with special forces. And then do what? So, but Siliguri corridor is a critical vulnerability for us. And you had rightly flagged that earlier there have been demands that North Bengal should be made a union territory.
Correct.
Because it's not border with four countries. You know, Nepal, Bhutan, you know, Bangladesh, and China wanting to get in somewhere. It doesn't have a physical border, but China wants to. And it has got large number of strategic establishments. You know, your Hashimara base is coming up, your Baghdogra Air Force base is there, and Katihar, Purnia is right next door. And then you have army bases, core headquarters and div headquarters, all that. And ITBP installations, SSB installations, you name it. All of them are BSF. Some of them are there. Because BSF looks after Bangladesh border. Right. SSB looks after Nepal border and Bhutan border. And ITB looks after China. See the complication mix here. How and there is no unified headquarter per se. You know, there are coordination headquarters. So there have been a thought that it should become a union territory. Earlier, ruling party was not so keen because it felt that route to capturing Bengal lies through union territory or through North Bengal. Because traditionally, North Bengal favors BJP. I'm sorry, I would have to name the party, but ruling party, let me put it that way. And in these elections also, they have won large number of seats.
Yeah.
But now there is a clamor to separate. There is a clamor. So I don't know whether it is true or not, but operationally, there is a question to look at it. It's difficult to do it, but there is. But more than that, West Bengal does not want to develop Siliguri to that extent. They have not given it always. They've given it a stepmotherly treatment.
Correct.
If there were good times, we should look at making Siliguri something like Hong Kong. Siliguri, Gangtok hub. See, after all, it's an education hub. People come to Darjeeling and Kalimpong for education from these countries like Bhutan, southeastern Nepal, Bangladesh. It's a medical tourism hub. Yeah. Large number of very complicated surgeries and all take place here. And diagnostics and all. Education, pharmaceutical plants are there in these areas. And you have this Manipal University there. Okay. Manipal Medical College.
Medical College.
So you can, sky is the limit if you apply yourself. There are casinos even in Gangtok. So if you want to make it a kind of a Hong Kong kind of a place, here is the place. We can do it. And before we look at finishing this interview, I would also like to flag one more issue to you. That when SAARC became totally dysfunctional or non-functional, India had tried to lean on towards the Act East. And we had tried to build up groupings like BBIN. Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal. It also tried to bring up BIMSTEC, you know, which is the Bay of Bengal scientific and that kind of initiative, which actually includes some more countries. It includes Myanmar, it includes Singapore, it includes, you know, Sri Lanka. It includes Thailand, the countries which border the Bay of Bengal, the BIMSTEC, you know, Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand, you know. So these countries, you put it to a mix like that. So through this route, we have tried to keep focus our attention towards activities. But I must concede, and I must say with great amount of pain, we have not succeeded in this. BBIN has not taken off. BIMSTEC is not going anywhere. So these groupings have not taken us very far. In ASEAN, we have some kind of an observer kind of status. We are not a full member there. So regional groupings there are not. And see, we wanted to make a corridor, which was Bhutan, China, India, Myanmar corridor.
ASEAN.
But that's not happening. It's only China, Myanmar corridor, which is taking place. We had made a route which went from Mandalay up to Mandalay. Kalemo, Kaleva. I've traveled on that route when I went to Myanmar. But it's stopped nowhere beyond that. we have this multi-modal Kaladan project, which is to come up from Sitwe and go to Zoroastrian and to come to Mandalay. But it's through river and it is through road and it links the Sitwe port to India. But that is also not gone any far, because now the problem of Arakan rebels has come up there.
Correct.
So if that be so, we are certainly not able to. This is the lament which is always there, and I'll come back to what you have started off with, Tista, Chinese wanting to come into this. The lament has always been of these nations has been, India does not deliver on these projects. India makes tall promises but does not deliver. So you know, there is the issue of Farakka Barrage between India and Bangladesh. That Farakka is the place from where we have to ensure that minimum amount of water goes to Ganges, water goes to Bangladesh. You know, because over there is this issue of delta and silting. So silt has to be flushed out. So they need minimum amount of water. We can do it through Tista. It's possible. But there are narrow parochial interests. If we do that, we lose vote banks in Northern Bengal. So are there any other ways to augment water supply? We have to think of these things. These are very like one thing good we did with Bangladesh is we did that exchange of enclaves.
Correct.
You know, water settlement. That was a very significant move we made. But we need to take it forward, reduce the vulnerability of Siliguri corridor by, there is another corridor kind of thing through Tatalia, which is a viable, which will increase the width of this corridor. Mm. So it's only a small stretch through the territory of Bangladesh. It links two sides of India because of the cartographic kind of thing. It's a very small stretch and Bangladesh may be agreeable. We have to work with them. Also, if we can somehow work out a transit corridor through Bangladesh,
correct.
And pay them some kind of money, bring up a rail connectivity to link with them, link up our ports with them. So these things have to be worked. But what happens in our context is these issues which are very emotive come up. And we say Bangladeshis are parasites. They are coming into India to take over all. They are very funny. For vote banks, we should not do these kind of
correct,
things.
Correct.
We should think strategically. Today, Bangladesh, incidentally, is taking off. It's an economy which is becoming tiger economy.
Yeah.
And it's a moot question that will people from India go there or will they come there if their economy takes off. So let's work in a cooperative kind of a mechanism. Through your interview, I definitely want to thank Sheikh Hasina Wajid. What a great leader. What a brave lady. I would like to give her a full-fledged general salute. She is the person who has taken this courage in her hands and she has thrown out all the rebels from Bangladesh. The people who seek sanctuary, the Ulfa people like Anup Chetia, and all these leaders who used to find sanctuary there, NSC and IM leaders like Anthony Shimran, they've been thrown out from them by this brave lady. And we should strengthen her hands. We will not, if she's forced to go the Chinese way, then we have to blame ourselves and no one else. We have to work with these countries. We have to find cooperative partnerships and we have to look at joint development and joint development. China does a good job. He must concede.
Correct, sir. I think China, and secondly, I also believe the United States. I mean, even if there's one pin that moves around the other side of the world from their country, they call it their national security interest and they take whatever action they need to. I think the national interest, I won't call it security at the moment, but the national interest has to be forefront in terms of any project or anything that we are doing. I completely agree with you. So I think there has to be a push with regards international national security interests kept in a very, 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 very high priority in terms of development of projects or links and relations with our neighbors. Sir, for your final comments, you also mentioned the Look East policy. I'd like you to kind of give us a roadmap as to where you would like to see the things moving forward, sir.
Adi, I would tend to believe that as regards dealing with China is concerned, we have to keep building up our capabilities and infrastructure in this area, remain vigilant. Many of our border areas have ghost villages. People who have deserted that area, gone away for education, and only minimal number of people live there. There has to be endeavor to repopulate those areas, take the development forward, at least take the tourism to those areas. There's a lot of talk. People say that I am hell of a patriotic kind of person. We have gone to the extent of nationalism also. We are all saying, Mera Bharat Mahan. But none of us are willing to go to those areas, spend time there, and send a message to China. The day schools in Bangalore start going and doing their excursions there, Chinese are not foolish people. China is doing it in Nepal. They are having Tibetan and Confucius study centers. They are setting it up. So, one part is that. Secondly, we must remain focused on Act East policy. We keep saying Think East, Act East, but this is only, I'm sorry to use this harsh word, only acronymist philosophy. We just keep giving acronyms and keep talking, but we have to operationalize this. We have to convert them into projects. Like Teesta was very much doable, but then Kolkata and Delhi are at war. Anything which originates from Delhi is shot down in Kolkata. And here Kolkata has acted very irresponsibly.
Irresponsible, correct.
They should have taken this project forward. They should have operationalized it in the long-term strategic interest of this country. And so we have to look at these things. Nepal is an area of concern for us, which is got connectivity here. Bhutan is comfort zone for us, but for how long? We have to remain focused on development partnerships with Bhutan. We can't just take them for granted, never, because there are demands in Bhutan also to have diplomatic relations with China and such like things. And we have to also handle Bangladesh and Myanmar. So these are our areas of concern, and somehow re-energize these regional groupings of BBIM, BIMSTEC, and make them functional with commitment. So Northeast is a big challenge, and also see, many Indians talk about Northeast in a very peripheral kind of a thing. See, till 1962 or so, the headquarters of Eastern Command incidentally was located in Lucknow.
Yeah.
So we thought Lucknow is East and beyond that is Far East. But that's not true. The East really starts when you cross Siliguri corridor.
Correct.
That is the Northeast. That is what it is. Mm. When I went on my posting to Zakama, people asked me, am I going on a foreign posting? Because if you hold a quiz today, in any school, which even wins the Bonvita quiz contest, and ask them capitals of 7 or 8 northeastern states and the names of capitals and their chief ministers, I am not sure how many will pass that quiz.
Correct.
And how many have ever gone to those areas. So, look at genuinely integrating those areas. And like, I part with one message that I want to say. You know, when in Bangalore, people in Northeast Bangalore and other places were thrown out. There was this wave of SMSs and all that happened. Yeah. And these poor people had to go back to their areas. So after a couple of months, all the employers were beseeching them, requesting them, begging them to come back, because we can't do without you. You have this soft skill which is not there in our guys. You have to run the malls, you have to run our resorts, you have to run our hotels, and they were got back. So I was commiserating with somebody, a DGP in Manipur, who's now the deputy chief minister. I was telling him that Joy Kumar, this is a very sad thing that India did to people for the Northeast. He said, no, General, everything has a time. And it is good that happened. And he says, what is better is that you called us back. And every time when you call us back, the message that goes to Northeast is, it's not a patronizing linkage. It's not the Northeasterns who lead India. It is India also who needs us.
Sir, that is brilliant. I think the hospitality industry from where I come from, sir, let me assure you, the people from Northeast are carrying the burden of it in places like Goa, in places like Coorg, which is very close by to Mysore, the coffee area of India, even in Bangalore for that matter, and Hyderabad and Mumbai. They are carrying the burden of the hospitality industry of India. And I absolutely agree with you. So it is not them who need us. They've been there. They've been very happy with what they have. But it's now India who needs them to be integrated within the society. Secondly, I agree with you with regards to tourism. There are places which have been unexplored. From the route bridges that are there to the deep jungles which are available there, which are nowhere around the world. And I'm sure you've seen them better than most of the people in, the general population of India. It is important for us to showcase that part. And I absolutely agree with you, sir. Sir, this has been a brilliant talk wherein we have taken up issues and we've tried to understand the various background of incidents that happened between India and China. We've actually tried to figure out why the Chinese actually came. We've given a very, very very, very clear answer about that. You've told us about the vulnerabilities as well as the advantages that we have in the East. Why are Chinese actually interested in that area? What the future holds for that area? As a matter of fact, we also touched about certain amount of international relations when we spoke about Nepal, we spoke about Bangladesh, we spoke about Myanmar. Finally, I think one of the biggest things that is going to rest by this interview is the question of the vulnerability of the Siliguri corridor, because once a person who's commanded that area says everything is fine, I think that is what we need to understand rather than the narrative which is being built up I'm not using this word very carelessly, in uninformed media personnel, which is the sad part of it. Thank you, sir, and this has been an eye-opener for me as well. I'd appreciate your time once again for another subject, another day. Till then, sir, Jai Hind.
Thank you, Adi. I really enjoyed this interaction. Like I had heard that you run a very professional YouTube program and this talk series. So you have gone beyond what I had heard. So thank you for this privilege and opportunity, and look forward to interacting with you again. And let me conclude on this note, that while Siliguri corridor is safe, but it requires a lot of effort on our part, and we should remember the poem, which was old poem that I learnt in my school by Robert Frost, miles to go before we sleep. The woods are indeed lovely, deep and deep, but challenges are too many. So there are miles to go before we sleep. Thank you. Thank you, Adi.
Thank you, sir. Jai Hind.